guys, Jonesy Phillips here on my brand new DVD Blu-ray Tuesday Shopping Video today. Today, gonna go out today, see what things came out, see what things are on sale. I know today, though, some of the big releases that come out are a Nutcracker and the Four Realms, and I believe Best Buy's gonna have a Steelbook of that one, as well as a Hunter's Killer, and that one, I believe there's a Steelbook as well for that one at Best Buy. Other than that, I think there's a couple other things today as well, like Suspiria, the new Suspiria film is out, and I think Boy Erased. Also, though, at the end of this video, I'm gonna have a whole bunch of brand new DVD and Blu-ray reviews for some things I received a review and talk about for you guys. Some really, really cool stuff. Some stuff from Arrow Video, Scream Factory, a whole bunch of new Vinegar Syndrome titles, as well as Severn Films titles, as well as a whole bunch of other titles as well. So a lot of really, really cool stuff in this video. Like I always say too, if you guys have seen any of the titles that I, you know, reviewed on DVD or Blu-ray, let me know, you know, what you guys thought of them and what you guys thought of the films and everything. But anyway though, guys, let's get going and see what we can find today.
Into Walmart we go.
And one thing I wanted to be sure to let you guys know is the horror comedy Dead Aunt, which stars Jake Busey, Sean Astin, and Tom Arnold, is now up on demand. So it's on like Vudu, Amazon, iTunes, and I have a really, really fun death scene in the movie. It's a really, really fun death cameo. So if you guys get to check it out, definitely let me know what you guys think. But it's a really, really fun movie, and the movie's called Dead Aunt, and it's now, like I said, up on all streaming platforms. There will be a DVD and a Blu-ray coming out in March. I'll be sure to let you guys know as well when that releases.
And in here today, like I mentioned, the big release that came out was Nutcracker and the Four Realms, and that one is $29.96 here for the 4K of that one. The standard Blu-ray is $24.96, and then it's $19.96 for the DVD of that one. Also today, Ballers, the complete fourth season here. This one released today, and that one is $14.96 for that. I've seen a couple episodes of this show, not a whole ton of the ones, but one of the things here that came out that they don't have on the shelf was a Hunter Killer, and that one is $24.96 for the 4K and $19.96 for the Blu-ray. Also, the newest Doctor Who release today. This is Doctor Who, the complete 11th season here. This one is the first time it's ever had a female Doctor Who. This one, I haven't got to see any episodes of this one. If you guys have seen any of these ones, though, let me know how that was. Also today, the new DC Universe movie, Reign of Superman. This one released today. This one is $24.99 here for the 4K. And some of the other things today was this one here, The Yeti Adventures. So I don't know what this one is here. This one is like some kind of animated movie. I don't think it's like a known character. I think it's just like kind of like the Yeti character. Also, Boy Erased, that was today. It's a really, really good movie. It looks like they only have the DVD of this one in here. But this is kind of funny, this movie here. Benchwarmers 2, which stars Chris Klein and John Lovitz. Benchwarmers 2, Breaking Balls. There's also going to be the Granddad Day Camp movie, which is like the third in the Daddy Day Camp series. But the only character that comes back in this is John Lovitz. And the original Benchwarmers, I remember liking, but if you guys have watched this one, let me know, though, how this one was. This one is $14.96 for that one here.
Into Target we go.
And I know it's been a few weeks since I've been inside a Target, because so often Targets don't have out the new releases. I'm in a different location today, one that I don't go to as often, so fingers crossed all the new stuff is put out.
And in here today, though, one of the exclusives they had was Reign of Superman, and this one has a Steelbook here for that for $29.99 for that. And they do have in here Boy Erased for $19.99 today. Like I said, really, really like that movie. Definitely one I recommend you guys check out. And they have Hunter Killer out here. That one's $19.99 for the Blu-ray and $24.99 here for the 4K of that one. And in here, though, they do have Willow is out again. It's back in print, and this one now has a digital copy with that one for $19.99 here for that. And they have Nutcracker on the Four Realms here today as well for $29.99 for that for the 4K.
So far, though, I haven't seen Suspiria, though, in any stores. I'm thinking Best Buy might have it. Also, though, in Walmart, one of the other things that came out that they didn't have on the shelf was the movie A Slice. That was one of the other things I don't think I mentioned in the video, though, because it wasn't on the shelf.
And this past weekend, I saw a couple different films. And the first one I saw was the film Serenity. You know, it stars Matthew McConaughey, Anne Hathaway, and Jason Clarke. And that movie, though, review-wise, though, has been a lot of really, really negative reviews. But I have to say, though, the movie is so different and so out there and so unexpected. And it was like, actually had some really original stuff to it that I totally 100% was not expecting at all. I don't want to say too much about it, but essentially, though, it's Matthew McConaughey's character is this fisherman who goes out on this boat, and he's like not having any luck, and he's like having all this bad luck, and there's this one fish that he's always trying to catch, and he's become like totally 100% obsessed with it. But like all of a sudden, randomly, it's like him on this island, out in the middle of nowhere, but his ex-wife from the past comes and says that she needs him to do something and take her current husband out on this boat and what she wants to, you know, him to do. And it's like, then it, but like I said, it has all these totally unexpected things happening that you would not think at all. And there's even a scene with Matthew McConaughey like reenacting like the, like this really famous Nirvana album cover in a way. It's like really strange, but I really, really liked it a lot. I mean, it's not perfect, but it's one of those movies you're gonna think about it after it's over for a long time and keep thinking about it and thinking about how odd and out there and different it is. The other film that I saw was the movie The Kid Who Would Be King. It's from the director who did Attack the Block, and it's got a similar sort of feel to Attack the Block a little bit, but it's basically about this kid who end up finding King Arthur's sword in this like construction site near his house when these bullies were coming after him and picking on him, and he sees it out there and removes it from the stone. And of course, though, he finds out that, you know, whoever, you know, removes the sword from the stone, you know, is the one who's like the true king. And it's essentially, though, about, you know, this creature under the ground, this evil like woman who's trying to come back and, you know, take down this kid and everything. And it was actually a fun movie. It had a throwback to like some of the 80s kind of like adventure films, kind of like, you know, all these kind of feels of things like Legend and Goonies and all these kind of things all kind of mixed together. And I actually really did like it. I felt like, though, the end wasn't as cool as some of the stuff like around, like, I felt like the first half is where it really had like a really cool adventure kind of feel. And then like near the end, it wasn't as cool as some of the rest of the stuff. It still was cool, though. But if you guys have seen either of those movies, though, let me know, you know, what you guys thought of them or what movies you guys saw this past week, and if you guys got to see anything.
Into Best Buy we go.
In here today, like I mentioned, though, they have the Nutcracker and the Four Realms exclusive 4K Steelbook here for $34.99 for that one here. So really cool Steelbook for that one. And the standard 4K is $29.99, and it's $22.99 for the Blu-ray of the film. And I think this one might have been today. Oceans, I believe. I'm not 100% sure, though. Other than that, though, over here, they should have a Hunter's Killer 4K Steelbook. It might be over there. No, here it is, right here, for $32.99. It's a 4K Ultra HD Steelbook of, you know, Hunter Killer. Like I said, this is one I haven't seen yet. If you guys have seen this movie, let me know, though, how that one was. Other than that, over here, though, I don't see anything else here too different. It doesn't look like they have Suspiria over here. I'll have to check the section, though, to see if they have that. They do have Reign of Superman here, and that one's $19.99 here for the Blu-ray of that one. Well, over here in the actual section, they do have Suspiria over here for $18.99. I really love this movie. It's like a totally different version of Suspiria. It's a, you know, a remake, but the story is really different, though. But I really love this. It doesn't have, though, the slipcover on that one, though. So that's really weird. It doesn't seem like they have the slipcover. They only have one copy. But they also have in here Boy Erased on Blu-ray here for $22.99. See any other different things over here. They do have Willow as well on Blu-ray for $19.99 here. Like I said, this is, you know, was out of print for a while, and it's finally got a new release and includes a digital copy. They have a DVD of that as well for $14.99. They also have over here Doctor Who, the complete 11th season here for $34.99. And other than that, though, I'm pretty sure that's all the major new things I see in here today.
So anyway, though, guys, that's all for my DVD Blu-ray Tuesday shopping video today. Like I always say, if you guys enjoyed these shopping videos, definitely give this video a thumbs up. Also, in the comments below, let me know if you guys picked up anything on DVD or Blu-ray today, and let me know as well what you guys thought of all the new DVDs and Blu-rays that I reviewed at the end of this video. So anyway, though, guys, thanks again for watching and subscribing. Now stay tuned for the reviews. And the first one I got here is from Arrow Video. I just want you guys to know that this one is available. And this is the giallo film here called The Possessed. This is from 1965. This is essentially, though, about this writer who's really depressed. He's trying to track down this old girl that he had liked and he had this fling with. And he goes to the hotel where she used to work. And essentially, though, he gets there, finds out that she's totally missing from the owner. You know, and she hasn't, like, pretty much vanished without a trace. And it's essentially about him trying to figure out exactly what had happened to her and kind of figuring out where she went and kind of all of the weird and strange things that he comes across trying to look for her and everything. This has on here, though, a brand new 2K restoration from the original camera negative on this one. Looks really, really good, as well as it has the original Italian and English soundtracks on this one. It has a new commentary track on here with writer and critic Tim Lucas. It has a video appreciation by a cultural critic and academic Richard Dyer on this one, as well as an interview on here with the makeup artist artist on the film, on this release here, as well as original trailers. Also, it has a booklet in here which has some pictures from the film and some stuff about the cast and about the production, all that kind of stuff in this one as well. But like I said, just want you guys to know that this one is available from Arrow Video. Now, the next one here is from Shout Factory Scream Factory line. This is a Sylvester Stallone movie here called Cobra, which this is one of those ones I couldn't remember if I had ever seen this one in the past. I was thinking I may have. I just really couldn't totally remember for sure, though, if I had. And essentially, though, this is about Sylvester Stallone's character, who is this cop, and he's kind of like the cop that they go to when they like end up like in like hostage situations and here or situations where there's like what normally like a regular cop wouldn't want to do it or get involved in it, or it'd be like something really dangerous or something. And Stallone's character basically will do anything. He'll kind of go into hostage situations and like go inside of like in the beginning of this movie, there's like this crazy guy who is like, you know, in the market, and he's like shooting people and everything, and Stallone's character ends up just going inside and trying to like take the guy out. And his methods too, he doesn't really care about, like, you know, he just wants to take the person out, and if there's like a threat or something, and like they send him in, and even though he's not doing things by the book, he's getting things done, but he's kind of like getting yelled at and stuff by like the police people that he works with and stuff. But essentially, though, this is about all these people are getting killed around the city. And you see right in the very beginning that it's like this van with like a couple different people in the van that are going around and killing people, and they're like relentlessly killing people. And it's essentially, though, the cops are trying to figure out, you know, who it is. And, you know, Stallone ends up, one of the witnesses, you know, played by Bridget Nielsen, you know, she ends up, you know, witnessing and seeing something, and, you know, about who it is and everything. And it's essentially, though, they're trying to come after her and take her out, and he's trying to protect her. And it's just a really, really intense, you know, thriller mixed with some horror elements, a little bit of horror elements in here as well, with like the killer aspects and stuff in this one. But I really, really like this movie. This is a really, really like intense movie. I thought Stallone did a really good job. This one is from 1986, so I think it was like right around the time that he did like Rambo 2, I think, or maybe Rambo 3. I'm not 100% certain, but around that period. But on here, though, it has a brand new 2K scan from the original film elements on here. It has a bunch of different interviews on here. It has an interview with one of the killers on here, Brian Thompson, on this one, some of the other interviews on here with Marco Rodriguez, actor Andy Robinson, as well as a commentary track on here with the director, vintage featurettes, teaser trailer, but really, really cool film here. The next one here is from Shout Factory's Shout Select line. This is a movie directed by Penelope Spears, and this is Suburbia. This is essentially, though, this one was from 84, and this is essentially, though, about... It's basically about this kid who ends up running away and leaving his house because his mother is a really big alcoholic and has all kind of problems, and she's always kind of yelling at him and yelling at his younger brother. And he kind of feels like, okay, if he's gone, then, you know, maybe the brother, it'll be a little easier in the house and they won't be so much worried about money and everything, because with him there, the mother's paying for him. So he kind of runs away. It's essentially about him finding this group of these kind of kids that are like a group of these punk kids, and like the punk movement and everything that was going on at the time, like, you know, their kind of clothes and everything. And he kind of joins in and with them and kind of becomes friends with them. But they're kind of like all running away from things in their own life, and like bad, terrible things that happen to them at home. And you kind of find out more and more about them, and they're all kind of like coming together and becoming friends because of this. But they're all like squatting in this house. But essentially, though, people in the neighborhood are trying to like get rid of them, and they're like really violent and like kind of dangerous people that are trying to get them out of their town. And the cops are kind of looking the other way. They're going, these are just kids, they can stay there. But it's essentially, though, about these the people that are squatting in the house, the group of these kids that are in the punk group, who are trying to like kind of survive and just kind of get away from their own home life and the stuff that they're going through. But a really, really well made film here. It has on here a brand new 4K scan of the original film elements. It has audio commentary on here with writer-director Penelope Spears, as well as a commentary with Penelope Spears and producer Burt Dragon, as well as actress Jennifer Clay, theatrical trailers, TV spots, and a still gallery on this one. The next one here is from Lionsgate, and William Dafoe has got an Academy Award nomination for Best Actor for this film, as well as, I think he had, I believe he did too, a Golden Globe nominee for this film as well. But this is essentially, though, about
Vincent Van Gogh, and this movie here is called At Eternity's Gate, and it's William Dafoe is the star of this. Mads Mikkelsen is in the movie as well as Oscar Isaac. And essentially, though, this is about William Dafoe when he was living in. Pretty sure it was in Paris where it was he was living. I'm pretty sure. And it was kind of all about, you know, because Vincent Van Gogh was the famous painter and, you know, he was known too for cutting off his own ear. And that was one of the things, you know, he was always known for that he did. And it's essentially, though, it's not like a biopic film where it's like follows him throughout like a long period of his life. It's all about a certain period of his time when he was doing like a lot of his work, like some of his more known work, I would say. But he was also kind of going through some of like own problems in his own life, and it was kind of about where he was going for inspiration and sort of trying to also kind of being misunderstood. Like he was going in like galleries and like in putting up his own pictures in these like this bar and these other places, and people were not really respecting him and looking at what he was doing was not amazing. And Oscar Isaac is someone who kind of pushes him to kind of go further with his art and go more out there and really look for more inspiration out in other areas and everything. Essentially, that's what it is. It's just a character piece all about Vincent Van Gogh, and the way it's shot and everything has a really, really cool, different look. You know, William Dafoe, though, did an amazing job, you know, playing this role. I've always been a fan of William Dafoe. He's always really good in everything that he's in. This is, you know, just a really, really great performance in this film. Has on here, though, a whole bunch of different featurettes on here about channeling Vincent Van Gogh, a commentary track on here with the director on here as well as the co-writer and on the film as well. And the next one here is from Lionsgate as well. It's a movie here called All the Devil's Men, which stars Milo Gibson. This is essentially about these undercover military operatives that kind of are sent in on certain type of missions and everything. And they're kind of like, they haven't done perfect, and they've run into some issues, and kind of like they're sort of at the point where they're like getting like their last chance to kind of get things right because of like the kind of mistakes that they've had in the past, or people got away and stuff like that. Essentially, that's what's going on, and they have to find this one guy who's with the CIA who they find out like might know something or might have been up to something bad. It's essentially, though, them trying to like, you know, to get this guy because they have to talk to him and to get this information from him, but he ends up like running off and getting away, and it's kind of like him going off throughout the city, and it's about them kind of trying to, you know, track them down, but then like the people are also coming after them because of stuff like that. So that's essentially what it is. It's like all through the city, and you know, it's one of those movies too where like the characters like don't know who they can trust because it's like a whole lot of stuff. They don't know if there could be somebody like involved with where they're working that could be giving information. It's one of those kind of things, like one of those not knowing who you can trust type of films here. This has on here, though, a featurette on the film as well. William Feitner is also in this movie as well, who is on the show Mom, and his character actor has been like a tons and tons of different stuff. The next one here is from Lionsgate as well, and this is Saban's Power Rangers, you know, Super Ninja Steel. Now, this is the second series of, you know, the Power Rangers Ninja Steel series, because the way Power Rangers has always worked, or at least for the last number of years, they do, like, Power Rangers, like, and they would be, like, Power Rangers, like, Ninja Steel, then they would become, like, Super, and it would be, like, something kind of changes to their characters, where they would have, like, some different things that they can do, and, like, a super form of, like, their, way they would, like, you know, transform and things like that to the, you know, the Megazords and that kind of stuff. Essentially, that's sort of what it is. But in this one, the story of the first series of the show was about these kind of star-type things that they had to put together that came down from space, and like they kind of fell to space, and that was kind of these teens that ended up finding, you know, the Power Rangers who ended up finding them and became the Power Rangers. But in the way it ends, though, this sphere ends up getting destroyed, and the Power Rangers lose their powers, but it ends up becoming like, they also thought, too, that they had destroyed their villain, because there's like interesting stuff in this, because it was basically about this planet where these aliens were kind of fight, you know, and put on like a show, like a TV show, of like fighting other aliens and everything. But essentially, though, they end up fighting at the end of the last season of this, the main bad guy, and they thought they, you know, had, you know, taken them out, but of course this bad guy is now coming back, and the Power Rangers end up, you know, getting their powers again because like they end up you know, because of a certain way they end up forming the powers back, getting the powers back. And essentially, though, it's about them with all sorts of other villains kind of coming after them and everything. The thing with Power Rangers, though, is I watched the show ever since the original series, since I was a kid, and always was a fan of this show. So it's always cool, though, to see how the show changes and, like, the kind of new kind of villains and stuff that they come across. And they still have the same kind of vibes and the humors that the show has had since the beginning. So I think that's really cool, though, that it still has that same feeling as the original series that I remember watching as a kid. The next one here is from Lionsgate as well. It's a movie here that stars Kevin Sorbo and Patrick Mulden called Bernie the Dolphin. This is about these two kids who end up... they kind of like live on this kind of island type area, and they're always going around, and they kind of go and like become friends with this dolphin that's out there. So they're always kind of swimming with this dolphin and everything, and they kind of just go off and see this dolphin on this this island area that they go to. But when they're there, though, they end up seeing Kevin Sorbo's character talking to this other guy, talking about how he's going to like change the whole island, and he's going to like, you know, be like, you know, basically redeveloping it and make all this money and everything. But he's going to kind of like have to figure out how he's going to like, you know, con the people off onto doing it and kind of pretending like he's going to do something else. And these kids end up hearing about this, and like, you know, Kevin Sorbo's like, you got to get them. You got it. What did they hear and all that kind of stuff? And it's essentially, though, them, you know, people coming after them, and these kids too are end up like filming it later. More stuff that he's saying he's going to do, and Kevin Sorbo's character is kind of trying to send people after them and like saying, "I'm not doing that. I'm going to actually build this like animal sanctuary there." And it's, of course, he's like making all these fibs and everything. It's basically, though, about these kids trying to figure out how they're going to stop this from happening and everything. So it's a really, really fun family film here. Has on here, though, a behind the scenes featurette on this one, as well as a trailer gallery. The next one here is from Paramount. This is a film that went originally straight to Netflix, and this is the third film in the Cloverfield series, and this is the Cloverfield Paradox here. And this is essentially, though, it's about like these set in space, about these astronauts who are up there working on this machine. It's like kind of like there's all on Earth and everything, there's all these sorts of energy crises and things going on, and these scientists are trying to work on a way to try to solve this, because like the world is basically like there's all sorts of like war, like on the verge of war happening, and all kind of problems because of the issues with energy and everything. And they feel like this machine that they're working on might be able to fix this. But essentially, though, they're in space, and they end up, something ends up happening with what they're working on, that they've been working up there forever on this thing, and it ends up kind of opening up this other dimension. And it's about, you know, basically them up there, and they're like discovering really weird things are happening up there, and it's kind of all this strange stuff, you know, that's happening. And it's actually kind of an interesting movie. You know, I actually like all the Cloverfield films. I think that, you know, this one, I think was originally like going to be something different, and then they ended up like adding some stuff to it to make it fit into the Cloverfield world a bit more. And I don't know if there's going to be any other future Cloverfield movies in the future or not, but I really liked all the ones, you know, that there have been. This has on here, though, the making of the Cloverfield Paradox, as well as a featurette here on the cast of the film. The next one here, Warner Brothers sent her a free copy of this one to let you guys know that this one is available, and this is a Fuller House, the complete third season here. Now, it comes to full, like, you know, to Full House, that was like when I think of like my earliest memories of like really watching a TV show. Like, my earliest was, I would say, Pee-wee's Playhouse, and then Full House. They were around the same time, and I remember them so well. And the thing with Full House was something that I feel like I was like the same age as Mary-Kate and Ashley on the show at the time. So kind of like what they were doing on the show, I was like remembering all this stuff, like the toys and like, you know, kind of what was talked about in pop culture at the time, and like the clothes. I remembered all the kind of stuff. So it was kind of like I grew up watching it, really could relate to everything. So it's a little different to see all the characters coming together now. You know, of course, Mary-Kate and Ashley aren't on the Fuller House series, but you know, it's kind of seeing where the characters are now in their lives, and you know, it's all about their, you know, having them having kids and their relationships that are going on, and their kids and their kind of what they're going through in school. So it's kind of like it's a similar kind of vibe, but it's a little different, though, you know, watching this now. So it's not as, you know, it's, you know, I look back at the original series as just such like a classic to me. So it's a little different seeing it now, you know, as an adult watching it. But still, it's really cool, though, and especially when they have like John Stamos and Bob Saget and Dave Coulier coming back in some of the episodes as well. I always think that's some of my favorite stuff, is to see them, you know, together again. Like I said, though, just want to let you guys know that this one is available Fuller House, the complete third season here. The next ones here are from Vinegar Syndrome. These are some really, really cool titles here. The first one is the movie here, which stars Brad Pitt and Rowdy McDowell, Martin Mull, Jill Sholin, and Donovan Leitch. Jill Sholin was in a movie I really liked as well, a horror movie. I think it was like 1990 or 1991, called Popcorn. And a movie that she did around the exact same time as this that I grew up watching as a kid and loved, which has never come to DVD or Blu-ray or anything, Babes in Toyland. You know, it was an early movie with Keanu Reeves that he filmed like the same time he filmed Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure, and Drew Barrymore was in it. I don't know, but like, you know, I was always was a fan of her. This movie here is called Cutting Class. This is essentially this slasher film. Very beginning of this movie, you see her, Joe Sholin's character, you know, who's her father, played by Martin Mull. He's going out in this hunting expedition, and someone ends up shooting with him with this arrow, and you know, basically try and kill him. And then, you know, essentially, though, it's all set at this high school, why the father is away after he was just shot, and you don't really know what happened. You kind of like, I don't want to say too much more, but essentially, though, you know, he was shot, and then at the high school, people there are getting kind of killed off. And it's like, the thing with this slasher movie is, this is one of the slasher movies that's like my favorite type, because it's like a comedy slasher film with like some really goofy characters. You know, Roddy McDowell's character is great in this. There's also this janitor character that is like this weirdo, strange janitor, which is amazing. He has these really strange scenes, and it's about, you know, basically the, you know, one of those sort of whodunit, and they did a really good job too, trying to make you wonder, who is it? Like, is Donovan Leitch's character, who recently got out of the nut house, is it him? Is it, you know, Brad Pitt's character? Is it the janitor? They were kind of like hinting at all these different people. They did a really good job. And on here, though, it has a brand new 4K scan for its original camera negative. Looks really, really good. And it has on here, though, a video interview with Joe Sholin here, video interview with Donovan Leitch, audio interview with the director on this one, audio interview with the cinematographer on this one, a commentary with the track where the hysteria continues. I always love their commentary tracks, because they always like do kind of inside facts about the movies, and like they kind of like poke fun at certain ridiculous things in them and everything. And it has on here, though, has a kill comparison, which shows the unrated and R-rated versions, because there was like, if you watch the R-rated version, I think this one came to DVD in the past, Lionsgate released it, or Anchor Bay, one of the two, I think it was Lionsgate, I believe it was accidentally released as like an R-rated cut, so it was all cut up and everything. But this shows you like the comparisons. This one on here is the unrated cut. So you guys, you know, it's totally uncut, but like they show like how they cut out all these different blood and everything. Like, that was definitely not the version to watch, that R-rated one, but a really, really fun slasher film here. And the next one here is from Vinegar Syndrome as well. It's a movie here called Bloody New Year. This is a movie, I always really liked this movie. I saw this one years back when it first came to DVD, and it was like one I always really liked. Now, I will say, though, it has a warning at the beginning of this movie that the original camera negative was like accidentally destroyed years ago, and the only one in existence had a lot of like print damage and like weathering and stuff like that, like some sort of scratches and like some kind of like decolorization and everything. So there's a warning on here about that. But I will say, though, they did a good job, though, cleaning it up with what they had to work with. And like I said, you do see like this bit of decoloration and some like lines and stuff in some of the footage and everything, but all the sound and everything is really good, and it doesn't like take away anything from seeing the movie. But it's basically, though, it starts off at this like carnival, and it's this really, really cool carnival kind of place. It's one of those kind of places I think is actually still there to this day. It's about these kids that are there kind of messing around, and they mess around with the carnies, and the carnies are kind of coming after them, and they end up taking this boat out, and they end up like kind of washing up on this weird island, and they go inside this island, and like they find like this kind of hotel place there, and it's like stuck in the past, and like there's like all these decorations, like holiday decorations up, and like tables are set, but like there's nobody there. It's like totally abandoned, but like I said, it's like stuck in the past. Like, I think it's like, I think, yeah, stuck in 1959, and this was set in 86. So it's like kind of what is going on there. And of course, weird things start to happen, and like really wacky kind of deaths and stuff in this movie. This is just a really, really fun movie. And the cover too, it has the reversible artwork to this other cover, so I love this image. This is like a real like famous kind of image people post when they say like Happy New Year. And I've always loved this. And it's like of this like Crypt Keeper kind of like skull and everything. It's just a great image. But it has on here, though, a commentary track on here with the director on this one. Next one here is another one that only ever was released on like a bootleg kind of quality edition of this. So fine, this is out, and it's it has on here too two different cuts of this movie. It has an alternate international edit, which is 93 minutes, and it's this movie here called The Uninvited or Uninvited. Uninvited was the yeah, that totally different movie. This is just called Uninvited. This is essentially, though, this is like a really fun, ridiculous movie about this cat that they were doing experiments on, and the cat ends up getting out, and like, and then the cat too, like, can like inside of the cat, like this creature comes out and like attacks and kills people, like this weird deformed creature cat thing inside of the cat, and it's essentially though about who's the star of this? It's Albert. No, George Kennedy, and it's basically him on this boat with, who's the other, Clue Gulager is in the film as well. It's basically about this guy who's, like, kind of on the run from the cops because he's, like, up to some shady business deals and stuff, but he ends up meeting these girls at this party and says they should come on the boat with him, and they're kind of, like, planning as, like, having them come just, like, as their cover-up for, like, their alibi of what they're up to and everything, because they're trying to, like, broker this deal and stuff. They're all kind of, all this shady kind of stuff, but essentially, one way or another, this cat ends up finding a way onto this yacht boat that they're all out on. It's basically about them getting attacked in these crazy ways by this cat and all these weird, wacky kind of things that are going on. It's a really, really fun movie. This has on here though a brand new brand new 4K restoration for the original 35mm negative on this one. Has a Conte track on here from the director. Like I said, the alternate cut of the movie. Has an interview on here with the cinematographer on this one. But just a really, really fun one. This one, as well as Bloody New Year, these both have slipcover editions you can order from Vinegar Syndrome. These ones are review copies, so they didn't have those ones on it. The next one here is another really fun slasher film as well, called Splatter University. And this is one, I was been a fan of this one forever. I think I remember like talking about this one in like early DVD update videos. Like I think like when the DVD first came out or something. Like it was a long time ago. I remember like looking on like message boards about this one years ago, like 2007, 2008. And this is basically though about this girl, this woman who comes to be a teacher at this school, and it's a really weird principle in this, and it's essentially, though, another really goofy, ridiculous, over-the-top slasher film. Kind of like, I don't know, it's a lot of other ones around this time that had, like, a similar sort of vibe. I'm blanking on what the name of some of the other ones were, but there was just a lot of ones around this time. They were, like, a real similar kind of feel. There's even a spoof movie they made that was kind of like this one. But essentially, though, they're all getting kind of killed off there in these kind of crazy ways. And it's another one of those ones where you're really wondering who is the killer and everything on that. This one as well has a slipcover edition. This one has a bunch of different features on here. It has a brand new 2K scan for the original 16mm negative. Has a commentary track on here with the director. A commentary as well with the Hysteria Continues talking about this film. Has an audio interview with the composer, still gallery, theme song, script gallery, radio spots, theatrical trailer, TV spots. So lots and lots of features on this one. And the last one from Vinegar Syndrome is a movie here called There's Nothing Out There, which is directed by Ralph Kanaski. And this was his, I think this might have been one of his earliest movies or one of his first ones that got like a lot of attention. And this is a film though about this weird type of creature that's out in the middle of the woods. These kids that are out there like camping in this kind of cabin. Essentially, though, this one guy is like this big film fan, and he's kind of like saying, this isn't looking good. I have a feeling that like things are going to be bad, and this isn't looking great. And of course, they're not listening and stuff, and it's this weird type of creature. It's coming after them and like killing them, this weird type of strange little creature. This is a really, really fun, ridiculous movie. It's another one that I've always really liked. And this has a brand new 2K scan from the original 35mm interpositive. This has tons of features. This has some of the most ones. It has 40 years of cutting, a new interview with the I believe that's with the editor on here, interview with actor Craig Peck, has a brand new group commentary on here with Ralph Kanaski, Joe Lynch, Jeff Riddick, 20th anniversary commentary with Ralph Kanaski, archival commentary on here, commentary with Hysteria Continues, music video, it has on here, see some of the other stuff, animation test footage, deleted shots, music videos, featurettes on here, so lots and lots of stuff, some really, really great Vinegar Syndrome releases. The next one here is from MVD, from their MVD Marquee collection, and this is a movie that stars Macaulay Culkin and Ted Danson. This has always been one of my favorite movies as a kid. I watched this movie so many times, and this is getting even with Dad. I remember seeing this movie in theaters. I always was sort of obsessed with this movie, because like, I always was a huge fan of Macaulay Culkin. And the writer of this movie, the writers of this did also wrote like Richie Rich, and I think The Flintstones, and and Stay Tuned. I wish they'd come back and write something new again, because I liked everything they wrote. But this is basically, though, about Macaulay Culkin character who's going to stay with his father, because he, like, his father is like, was in prison. He's kind of always up to no good, his father, and he's like never really been in his life, and his mother kind of drops him off, and for one reason or another, and says, you know, you're to stay with your father. And the father's like, at this time, is planning on having this, stealing these coins, and like, he has all these kind of plans, and he just stole them, and he's like hiding them and everything. And basically, though, Macaulay Culkin's character finds out about these coins and holds them for ransom, and basically makes the father and the two people that work with the father that stole these coins, it's like, makes them take them places and like do stuff with them. I love this movie. This is such a fun movie. The other one of the actors that plays the bad guy, or the bad guy that stole the coins with the father, was in Ernest Goes to Camp and Ernest Scared Stupid, and he played Chuck, you know, the character Chuck, and I was always loved that guy. But like, it's just a really, really fun movie. It has on here, though, some features that I don't think had ever been released on the DVD or anything in the past. It has a making of featurette, music montage featurette, and it also has, which is really cool, a home video teaser trailer, which I never saw that trailer. If I did, it was like on a VHS or something, and it was like Macaulay Culkin talking about like, oh, my father never did this, and it was like all these weird pictures of where his father was and stuff. It was just, I don't know, it was like kind of like, like saying, yeah, when I was like my 8th birthday, I was in here because my father was in Hawaii with his other girlfriend. And when he was this time, he was in jail. I don't know. It's just a cool feature on there. And the next one here is from the MVD Rewind collection. And this one here, I always love the looks of the Rewind collections. They have these really cool slip covers that are designed like old school VHS. They have like stickers on them, like Be Kind Rewind, Martial Arts. But this film here is the film Double Dragon. This is from 1994. This is around the time when they were doing a lot of like martial arts films. And I remember seeing like all these ones in theaters and really liking, like Sidekicks was another around this time, as well as Three Ninjas, Surf Ninjas. This is essentially though about these two brothers, and it's about they have this part of this amulet, and it's about Robert Patrick's character trying to track down this amulet so he can kind of like control everything with the power of this amulet. And it's about these kids, you know, getting like having people coming after them and everything. It's a really, really fun movie. This has on here though a high definition transfers the film on this. It has a new making of a Double Dragon full-length documentaries with interviews with the stars on this one. It has on here a featurette on Don Murphy, Portrait of a Producer. Has archival making of featurette, behind-the-scenes featurette, Double Dragon animated series pilot from 1993, theatrical trailers. It has on here VHS home video trailer. And inside as well, the one thing that's cool with the Rewind collection is they include a mini poster. So it has the mini poster for the movie as well, and it also has the reversible artwork as well for the alternate poster here on the Blu-ray. It's a really, really cool one. This one here is from MVD as well. This is an anthology film from the directors who both did, Tales from the Hood and Tales from the Hood 2. And this one here is American Nightmares. And this one, I will say, I like this one a lot more than I like Tales from the Hood 2. I thought Tales from the Hood 2 was okay. The first Tales from the Hood was amazing. That's like probably one of my favorite anthology films of all time. Like at least one of like the top like five or so, like maybe like number two or something. But it really is one of my favorites. This one though, this really felt like, to me, you could almost have called this Tales from the Hood 3, because it has that similar vibe. And it's, the stories are a little shorter, though, because in Tales from the Hood 2, there were some stories that were like 40 minutes and stuff. Most of the ones in this are like around like 10 minutes or so. And it's basically about Danny Trejo's character, introducing the segments and about these two weird hackers that are like watching these cams and stuff like that, and like the cams get hacked, and you see Danny Trejo's character telling these with him and Michelle Nichols telling these kind of stories. And it kind of cuts to each story. And I really liked a lot of the segments on here. Like, one of them was Chris Kattan's character playing this weird, creepy guy who dresses like a clown. And what ends up happening, Brendan Sexton III, who was in, you know, the film Pecker and Hurricane Streets and lots of stuff. And Welcome to Dollhouse, I think he's probably, and Boys Don't Cry. But he has a great segment in here when he's like this terrible racist guy. And he like makes this time machine to go back in the past. And like a bad
twist happens when he goes back in the past. And then Clarence Williams III, which was so cool that they got Clarence Williams III, who you know was the host in Tales from the Hood. He is in here. And that segment, it was about this guy who was like this preacher who's kind of selling like fake blessed water and stuff like that. And he was kind of a sham and everything. And Clarence Williams' character is all like has like a crippled hand and everything. And what he ends up doing to him, it's because of something that happened to his daughter. It's just amazing. I really like this. I thought this was actually a really, really good anthology. Some really, really good segments on this one. The next one here, this is from Coach Media, and this is a German release, and this one is a region-free release. You guys can watch this one on any Blu-ray player. There's no region code locking or anything. And this is a movie that stars Claire Danes, Kate Beckinsale, and Bill Pullum, and I remember seeing this in theaters, always really liked this one, and I don't believe this one has ever had a Blu-ray release in the U.S., and I always liked this, so when I heard this was out, I was really glad to get a copy of this to review, and this is Broke Down Palace, and I have a link to the company's website. And this is basically about these girls who are on this trip, and they end up meeting this guy, and I think it was in Hong Kong. I can't remember exactly where, was it Bangkok? I can't remember exactly where it was, but essentially, though, they meet this guy, and he ends up putting, kind of like starts to like these girls, and he's kind of messing with them because he wants them to kind of trick them because he wants them to smuggle these drugs in. Of course, they don't know that's what's happening, and they end up going to the airport and getting arrested because they find drugs in their bag, and it's like they end up getting put into this horrific prison, and like they're all kind of denying that these girls knew anybody, and they thought they were just smuggling these drugs. So they basically end up getting in there and getting like 36 years in prison. And Bill Pullum's character is their lawyer trying to figure out how he's going to get these girls out. And it's just an intense movie. Always really love this movie, and so cool this one has a Blu-ray release. Like, if you guys haven't seen this one, and if you have too, let me know what you guys thought. The next one here is from Gravitas Ventures. There's two different ones. This is a documentary here called Cam Life. I just covered up a few things on some of these upcoming ones, just in case no one says anything. This is basically a documentary all on the world of cam girls and cam guys and everything that like do, you know, adult cams and everything. And it goes in and gets into all these aspects of it that I can't believe they got to film, about like how some of these cam places that are in like other countries and stuff, it like run by these like group of these people, and they have like these fake sets, and they have like 7 or 8 different rooms, and it has like this group of all these employees that are kind of controlling the cams and everything, and it's like these fake, I don't know, it's a really interesting kind of thing, and it's kind of talking about interviewing cam performers about like what they're like, kind of about their life and how they make their money, and all these different kind of behind the scenes fact about the whole interest. It's kind of actually very interesting talking about this stuff and showing like the adult conventions and the you know, adult cam conventions, and talking to the owners of some of these sites and everything. This one here is from Garrett's Ventures as well. This is a movie here called Dark Highlands. This is basically though about this this artist who's out in the middle, I think it was, you know, in the middle of Scotland, and he's working on like these paintings and things like that. But essentially though, he's out there, and there's this weird kind of guy in this kind of mask and stuff who's kind of stalking him around. He's like kind of got like this weird hood thing on, these goggles and stuff, and he's kind of stalking this guy. He's also going after other people that are out there, but it's just this weird crazy stuff going on about this guy who's out there and this weird person who's kind of watching them and watching him from afar, and he's kind of like taking this guy's water and messing with his things and stuff like that. So it's kind of like little by little it gets worse and worse and worse with what's going on here. This has on here though a filmmaker's commentary on the Blu-ray. The next one here is a bunch of new releases from Severin Films to let you guys know are available. This one here is Jack the Ripper, and this is a movie here from 1959. It has on here the it has two different versions on here, the UK and US versions of the film. And it's basically, though, you know, the story of Jack the Ripper. You know, there's been a lot of different films throughout the years of Jack the Ripper, like, of course, From Hell with Johnny Depp, and, like, a lot of different ones. This is essentially, though, about a person who's trying to, the inspector is trying to track down and figure out who is Jack the Ripper. And this one, though, you see the character and stuff, and he's this really weird guy and everything. It's just a crazy, you know, story of Jack the Ripper. Has on here, though, a commentary track on here with the co-director, co-producer on this one, alternate alternate takes from the film, interviews on here with Dennis Mielek, who's the author of Jack the Ripper, The Murder and the Movies, the real Jack the Ripper featurette, theatrical trailer, as well as a poster and still gallery on this one. This one here is a giallo film called All the Colors of the Dark.
And I think it's spelled like C-O-L-U-R in like some of the UK releases I've seen, because that's how they spell it in the UK. So I always remember it seeing it spelled that way. But it's basically, though, about this girl who ended up, this woman who was in an accident, ended up losing her child. And she ends up like, it's basically like her going through all these weird type of visions and seeing all of these weird type of like super creepy things. Like there's like some really creepy kind of like segments in this one, like especially like in the start of this, it's of things that this woman is seeing and coming across. And it's just a really, really out there creepy movie and amazing music. The music in this, and that's one thing that's cool about this one, is this one includes in here a limited edition soundtrack. So it has the soundtrack to the movie in here, and it's amazing music, and it's just a really, really great giallo. So when it comes to some giallo films, some of them I feel like are kind of more interesting than others. This one is probably one of the most interesting ones. Very hard to explain all what's going on, but just very creepy. This has on here, though, They're Coming to Get You, the alternate US cut, has an interview on here with the director on this one, interview with the screenwriter, interview with George Hilton, Italian horror film expert, as well as an audio commentary track on this one. This one is limited to 2,500 copies that to have the soundtrack. And then this one here is All the Colors of Giallo. And this is a documentary on the Giallo films. And it kind of covers like all the... It has a whole bunch of different stuff on here, though, because it has on here over 4 hours of trailers, like Giallo horror trailers on this one. It has a commentary track on this one as well. And it has a trailer compilation as well. So like a whole ton of different trailers, as well as a CD soundtrack, which has a bunch of different music as well from some Giallo films. But if you guys are fans of Giallo movies, this kind of, kind of goes through a whole lot of different ones and kind of like what makes a film a Giallo and all that kind of stuff. So some really cool releases here. And this one here is from Severin Films as well. And it's a movie that stars Ted Raimi, Ricky Lake, and Tracy Lords. And this movie was from 1993. This was a movie called Skinner, and I remember seeing like the cover of this one years back. And this is basically though about Ted Raimi's character, who is this kind of guy who's going through, and he ends up staying at Ricky Lake's house because she has like a room for rent, and he's like this crazy weird guy who's going out at night and skinning people, and it's like these insane sequences and stuff like that. And Tracy Lord's character has like some scars and stuff on her body, and like she's kind of trying to track down Ted Raimi, essentially. He's kind of, it's basically though this serial killer movie about him and these insane sequences and stuff. And it's one of these movies too where it kind of builds up, and I feel like it gets like crazier and crazier as it goes along. Ted Raimi though did a really, really good job in the film. It has on here though an interview on here with the director, interview on here with Ted Raimi, bargain bin VHS interview with the screenwriter on this one, flaying sequence outtakes and extended takes, so some extended takes of some of the gore sequences on this one. And the last two here are from Severin Films. I had to cover over a couple of things just so no one says anything. And these are like kind of in the Mondo series type of things, where like these kind of sort of fake sort of documentaries, sort of Faces of Death, kind of what they were doing, where there's some things that are maybe real, or some things that are real, some things that are kind of made up or and stuff like that for the film. And this has two different ones here. This has Mondo Fredo, Mondo Bizarro, and then East Echo, and then the Forbidden. And this is all about, like I said, it goes through in these ones, and it's talking about like the world of like prostitutes in Tijuana. It has on here like Satanists on here, these kind of like topless clubs. And these were all made in these were in the 60s. So these ones, 66, 64. So these were really taboo kind of stuff at the time. And it goes through on here, they're all kind of, like I said, shockumentaries, shockumentaries. That's what these kind of films are. But it has on here, though, on the one here that has Mondo Bizarro, has a commentary track on here with Johnny Legend and Eric Caden. It has on here The Cadaver is Infinity with The Birth of American Mondo. And then on here this one has the Bandit producer, Goldstein. David Goldstein remembers Bob Kreese, as well as I Want More short films. Like I said, these are hard to explain, but it kind of deals with Satanists and all kind of like shocking things at the time. This one has music by Riz Artello, who did music in Mondo Cane and lots of different stuff. And the next one here is from Wow Now Entertainment, and I'll have a link where you guys can order this one for the best price. It's an anthology film here called Hashtag She, and this is all the segments in here are directed by female directors. So that was a really cool thing about this.
this. And it's all like horror and science fiction and creepy out there weird kind of segments and stuff like that in the movie. One of the ones that I really liked though was about these people who were going to this music festival, and it was kind of about this sort of like type of this drug, and really weird, crazy things were happening there. There's some really, really crazy, out there, nut stuff going on in this movie. The next one here is from Unearthed Films. It's a movie called Purgatory Road. This is essentially, though, about this priest and his brother, and they're really messed up, and it's sort of Henry Porter of a serial killer a little bit about these two going around. They're going around in this RV, and in there, though, they have, like, a priest confessional, and they're going around, though, killing people that they think are sinners for the things, and, like, people are kind of coming in there to confess, and they're, like, killing them, and it's one of these movies, too. If you guys are, like, fan of, like, gory films and, like, super, super gory movies, there is some insane gore. All the Unearthed Films that Unearthed Films has released, pretty much all of them are, you know, focus a lot of stuff on aspects on the gore, so super, super gory and amazing gore effects in this one, so really well done. Crazy gore, but it's essentially though about this crazy priest who's going around killing these people, and there's some crazy scenes kind of like reminding me a little bit like of like Carnival a little bit, like when they're setting up these tents and like people were kind of coming there and he was having his own church with all these crazy things he was saying. It has on here though a commentary track on here, a bunch of different featurettes, as well as a Q&A on this. The next one is from Wild Eye Releasing, and it's a movie called Karis Hell, and this is a really fun movie. This is basically about this carousel unicorn that's on this carousel, like in this kind of theme park place, and the carousel unicorn is talking, saying, "I'm so tired of what I'm doing, I hate my life, and I hate these kids," and it's basically about this bad kid that ends up coming there and sitting on him and messing around and stuff, and this carousel horse is kind of like, unicorn has had like enough of it all, and he goes on like a killing spree and like escapes and goes around. It's basically just like this plastic horse though, but like they find these crazy ways of people getting killed. It's kind of like him going after this kid, and this kid's sister is having this party, so there's all these people who are getting killed off there, and it's just a totally ridiculous but really, really fun movie. It has a commentary track on here, cast and crew interviews, deleted scenes, bloopers, and a trailer on this one. And the last one here is from Strand Releasing. This is called Postcards from London. This is basically, though, about this kid who ends up telling his parents that he wants to go to London and kind of like get away, and like kind of feels like that would be where he would like to live. He goes out there and kind of like is starting to live on the streets at first, and he ends up meeting these kids, these boys who are all like these prostitutes, and he kind of like becomes friends with them and becomes in their world. And the whole way the movie is filmed, it's like it's kind of filmed like a stage play a little bit, like it's like these, like the way the sets and everything look and the way it's lit is almost like it's like on a stage a little bit, and like a majority of some of these scenes, and it's kind of about him with, you know, in this life and what he's going through, and then like the people that kind of come into it, and like clients and stuff like that. It's really actually interesting. Like I said, it's all about like the way this is shot and put together. It's just got a really, really interesting look and everything. On here though, it has a the theatrical trailer on this one, as well as trailers for other Strand releasings. And the next ones here are all from Umbrella Entertainment. Now the Blu-rays are all region-free releases, so you guys can watch these ones on any Blu-ray player all around the world. They have no code locking or anything like that on them. The first one here is a film called Apt Pupil, which is based on a story by Stephen King, which stars Ian McKellen, Brad Renfro, and Bruce Davison. It's a movie I always really liked, a really underrated film. It's basically though about Brad Renfro's character finds out that his neighbor was a Nazi, and he comes over to his house and starts like telling him this, and he says that I know this, and the guy's kind of worried about it, and like, and he's basically though telling, you know, Ian McKellen's character, who's playing the Nazi that he found out about, you know, I want you to tell me everything. I want you to tell me everything about what you did, about how things were done. And you can tell, though, there's something really, really off about Brad Renfro's character. And the movie just takes these insane turns and what he's doing and everything and the way he's really bothering this guy coming over there all the time. So really, really well-done movie. It has on here behind the scenes, theatrical trailer, and TV spots. The next one here, this is on the Ozploitation Classics line, and stars Henry Thomas. I think he did this right around the same time as, like, a little bit after E.T., and this is a movie here called Frog Dreaming, which is also known as The Quest. This is directed by Brian Trenchard-Smith, who did Dead End Drive-In, Leprechaun 3, a bunch of movies I really like. Dead End Drive-In, though, is one of my favorites of his. This is set in Australia. It's about this kid whose parents died, and he's living in Australia. And he comes to, like, start to find out about these, like, myths and stuff about this pond and about these creatures that live in the pond, and he starts believing that there really are there. It's basically about him, though, trying to, like, investigate and
and see if he can find these things. It's a really fun movie. I saw this one years and years back. Like I said, it was also known as The Quest in the U.S. Has on here, though, a comedy track on here with Brian Trenchard-Smith, as well as the editor. Has extended interviews from the Not Quite Hollywood documentary, you know, talking about this film here. As well as some other featurettes on here, with a cast on here, Dream Quest shooting locations revisited, so showing what the shooting locations look like now. But a really, really fun movie. The next one here, these are from the Ozploitation Erotica double feature line. This is up from the, you know, that's what they're called, Ozploitation Erotica double feature, but it's from the Ozploitation Classics line. This has on here two films, Felicity, as well as Center Spread. Felicity, though, is about this girl who's kind of like, you know, starting to like discover things about sexuality, and she's like sleeping around and like all these kind of things going on. And Center Spread, though, was about this guy who was a photographer trying to find the best, like kind of like a different girl for this spread. And it's essentially what it is like the person who runs the magazine and everything wants to find somebody really different, not like totally with the norm and stuff. And that's essentially what it is. Has on here, though, a commentary track on here on Felicity with the director and star, Confessions of an R-rated movie maker featurette, extended not quite Hollywood interviews on this one, image gallery, and on Center Spread it has behind the scenes featurette, interview with the producer, as well as an alternate UK cut of the film. This one here is now this one is a region 2 release. You guys have to have a region free Blu-ray player to watch this one, so this one will not work in a US Blu-ray player. And this one is called Lost Gully Road. It's about this girl who's waiting for her sister to come to this cabin, and she's like, just wait, I'll be there really soon. But when she's out there, though, she starts like hearing weird things and noticing there's odd stuff going on, and she starts like hearing like these whispers and all kind of odd stuff. And it's essentially, though, about her kind of out there, and it's kind of like, is there somebody else out there with her? And it's kind of her wandering around the woods and stuff, but a really kind of creepy concept movie. There's a lot of type of films like this, but I thought this was actually one of the better ones of this style of what is going on here. And then the last one from Umbrella Entertainment. Now this one, the Celia movie is region locked, so you guys have to have an all region DVD player for that. But the Tale of Ruby Rose, that one, you guys can watch that one on any DVD player that doesn't have a region code locking. And this is Celia is basically about kind of has horror elements about this girl, set in the 50s, about this girl who becomes friends with this family, but the parents like don't want her coming by because they find out that they're like have like these ties to this communist party. That's what it is. And then the Tale of Ruby Rose, though, and it's, I was thinking about if Ruby Rose like got her, maybe that was like a stage name or not for her, and maybe she got the name from this movie. And that one is on here as well. But this has on here film review and interview with Alan Turner from the Shady Sunday, audio interview with David Stratton, a still gallery, and a German theatrical trailer. The last one here is from this one is from Cult Epics, and it's a movie here called Blue Movie. Just want to let you guys know that this one is available from Cold Epics. This is basically about this guy who just got out of prison, and it's like things really changed after he got out of prison. It's essentially about him kind of finding out about like different stuff in the world and like more openness to sexuality and like people like that kind of stuff. And it's basically about him meeting this girl and trying to like plan these kind of like meetups, like swinger kind of meetup kind of things, and like sleeping with a lot of other kind of people and things like that. This has on here, though, a brand new HD restoration and transfer from the iFilm Institute for the 16mm reversal and 35mm duplicate negative. It has an interview on here with the Wim Vetstrand, interview on here with the producer, interview with Hugo Masters in Paris. So these are all new interviews. Blue Film Institute featurette, Blue Movie HD poster and photo gallery, original Scorpio Films theatrical trailers on this one, but looks really good on Blu-ray as well. But anyway, though, guys, that's all for the reviews here. Lots and lots of reviews in this video. Thanks so much for watching and subscribing, and I'll see you guys later.